certainly am honored to be, I think, the fourth in this series. John Richards, Martin Hazel, and Alan Grant. And I would say that that was wonderful company to be in. Well, my first major speech at Basel was right here on the stage, and it was my inauguration. And at that time, I talked about, I used a little bit of a theme of my absolute favorite movies. And so I thought, well, in my last time to talk to you, that's what I would do again. Now, it is no secret what my favorite movie is for those who know me. In fact, if I said right now, probably people could shout it out. 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, I was at a retirement party that some friends had for me in Kansas City, and there was a little trivia contest about some things about me. And one of the questions was, what is Dr. Pat's favorite movie? Well, they shouted out, It's a Wonderful Life. I love that movie. Now, for our students, I just want to poll here. How many of you have seen that movie? Well, actually, that's better than I thought.
Listen to some of my personal stories as we go along, because that really goes
those are people that have made a difference and helped me think about even saying that I've had a good life. Now, I'm going to sort of divide this into three loose categories, so if you'll bear with me. I'm going to talk about the person within. I'm going to talk about relationships with others. And then I'm going to talk about how to make a difference for good. Sounds a little like our Quest program, or it sounds a little like our leadership at Springfield, doesn't it? So let me give you some ideas about that individual within, and how we can look back and hopefully say we've had a wonderful life. First, be a person of integrity. Be a person that other people can trust. Some of us had a great opportunity just yesterday, to go to the NAIA Champions of Character Luncheon. And the guest speaker was Tom Osborne. And for most of you know that he was the winning coach at Nebraska for years. And as he was talking about what's important in terms of character, the first thing he said was, you must have integrity. Now, I just want you to know, I wrote the speech before I took her Tom Osborne yesterday, okay? But it was good to know that my idea was also reinforced by him. There's one particular scene in the movie, when you watch it, and you'll see that the local banker, and I don't know if Ivan is here, but he's not like our local bankers here. His name's Mr. Potter. He's sort of, you'll find out in the movie, kind of this despicable character. But he's trying to convince George to come to work for him. Now, he's going to offer him more money, he's going to offer him more prestige, and he's going to offer him a shorter workday. And there's this point in time where George says, he's really thinking about whether he should take that job. And then he realizes that if he does that, he'll be working for someone that he really despises. He'll have to give up his family business. And then he realizes that the people in town, the working people in town, won't be able to buy homes or businesses. And so George takes the harder path. He takes the honest path. He takes the path of integrity. Now, all through your lives, there are going to be times that you're going to be tempted a little bit with more money, or maybe more prestige, or maybe a shorter day, or something else. And it may be the big and small things. But I'd encourage you to really look at those opportunities and make sure that they're ones that fit your value system and who you are. I grew up, most of you know, in a rural part of Missouri. And I've told this story many times that we didn't have much money in our family, but we had a lot of love, and we had a name that was respected in our community. I spent a lot of summers with my mother's parents. They lived on the farm, and we spent summer nights sitting outside talking instead of being inside watching TV. It was the coolest place around because we didn't have air conditioning. My grandfather, who had less than an eighth grade education, was one of the best storytellers that there was around. He was also one of the smartest men I had ever met. But he would talk about our family and how hard we had worked as in our ancestors and the generations before us to make a living, to buy the farm, and to be where we were. And he'd say, we don't have much money, but we have our name. And our name is one that people can come to when they have a problem or when they need something. And then he would look at me and he'd say, protect our name. And so I would say to you that if there's this little voice in the back of your head somewhere, when one of those temptations come, and it's testing your integrity. Think that little voice in the back of your head. And what would make you say, I'm going to take the harder path. For me, it was always my grandfather saying, protect our name. Second thing about being as as you as a person as you develop, I would say to find some people that can really help you along the way. Find a good mentor. Find somebody that will inspire you, that will help you when you are down, and take their advice. I wouldn't be standing here today if I hadn't had wonderful mentors along the way. In every job I've ever had, I've had wonderful mentors. I think it started early. I talked about my grandma Hoyt, that's what I was talking about, and he was probably my first life mentor. But my second one, my first work mentor, was a woman named Shirley. Now, I was 13 years old when I started working in a local cafe that was much like the Baldwin Diamond. And I knew absolutely nothing about waiting tables. Even at that time in my life, my family probably had been in a restaurant for a few times to eat. So this was kind of foreign territory to me. And as I look back, one, I wonder why in the world they hired me. But secondly, I know that if it hadn't been for Shirley, I would have been lost. Now you're going to find when you leave Baker that there's going to be times in your work life, especially, where you're going to feel lost. You don't know how to do a project, you don't know what about the culture, you don't know something. So find someone that's willing to help you, that will give you good advice, that will lead you through that time. And then listen. And a lot of times there are people out there and you just don't listen, A few years ago, I had the great honor of going back to this little high school where I was working in that same town, and for my niece's graduation, they asked me to be the graduation speaker. And there, at the end of my speech, at the end of graduation, sitting right over here, was Shirley. And Shirley's fairly old now. And she made her way to me, and she said, "You know, I am so proud of you tonight." Well, I'll tell you, that was one of my proudest moments. But as I looked at her, what I realized is it was the joy that she had because she had helped me get where I am. You know, students, that's why we do what we do so many times, the faculty and the staff here, that we work because we love to see you succeed. I look at our students and our recent grads, and I am so proud of them. Josh Warner, I'm even calling you out, because it's fun to see you here tonight and what you're doing. But we've had students that go on and do amazing things. And you know, we have some that are working for us right here at Baker that are some of our recent grads. And I think of people like Chris and Katie and Gary and Warren and Connor and Matt and Todd and Clarence and Hannah and Savannah and others who are doing a great job for us. Some, they may stay a long time at Baker or they may go home. And for them, and some of them are sitting right here, what I'm going to say to you is, you've had wonderful mentors along the way. You're doing a great job for us. Now it's time for you to start raising those next people up for you. Third, I'd say that for the person within, think about being positive and try to be nice to everyone. Now Shirley would tell me, always be nice to everyone. For her, that meant that we were likely to get more tips. That was very important. You make 50 cents an hour, it's very important. And it also meant that you were going to have good working relationships with others, and they would probably help you. It's great advice. Great advice. But there's also research that shows that being positive can make a difference in your outlook, in your health, and certainly in the ways that other people react to you. I told you earlier about my nights at Grandpa and Grandma's. Well, my mornings started early. They got up very early. They lived on the farm. And there was this farm show on the radio that was hosted by Bill Ring. And every morning, Bill Ring would start the show, and he would say, don't worry, I'm not going to sing it, but he would sing it. That's the other thing at the trivia contest, I said, one thing that Pat doesn't do well, everybody shouted out, sing. So I'm not going to sing. But he would sing, "Oh, what a beautiful morning, oh, what a beautiful day. I've got a wonderful feeling that everything's going my way. I walk early in the morning, am at Baker, 5:30 or 6 o'clock, spend about 30 minutes walking. And when I start that walk, that's the first thing that I sing to myself. Oh, what a beautiful morning, oh, what a beautiful day. I have a wonderful feeling that everything's going my way." And then I repeat the song that you'll hear me say at your graduation. "This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I want my day to be positive. I want to start my day in a way that I can be positive so I can be positive for others. I think of the faculty, the board members, the staff, my colleagues, who are just great living examples of positive influences, and they're just nice people. We know who they are. You know who they are, just think about it. Who are they?" But they're the ones that inspire us, they're the ones that we want to be around, they're the ones that whose lives we want to emulate, they're the ones that we just would love to have a cup of coffee with. They're the ones that really care. I can't name all of the people that have done that for me here, but I am going to name one name because she's leaving in December, and you know who that is, Nurse Ruth Simon. If we could all have her positive influence and her positive attitude, wouldn't we be that? Thank you, Ruth, and wherever you are, where are you?
Better job for me, and you didn't want anything
except the best for mayor. I have the best board chairs that anyone could ask for. Bob Hunt, Suzanne Teal, Peterson, Bridget. Thank you for your support. To the people in my office and my senior leadership team, Mary and Susan, Brian, Jared, and Myra. And faculty members and staff and other leaders on campus who have been candid and caring, I thank you. And I hope I put Brian's name in there. We both did it again. Myra and Susan, Brian, Jerry, and Mary. Next piece of advice I'd say is love well. When you find that someone who has whispered this right, then love well. When Dennis and I got engaged, one of my math professors at Southwest Baptist, John Smashing, took me into his office. I was a work study student. And he said, I just want to know, does he love you more than he loves himself? And then he looked at me and said, you love him more than you love yourself. He wasn't saying he wanted me to give up my identity for him or anything like that. He was saying, have I found someone that would put me first and I'd be willing to put him first? This is going to kill me for this. But we celebrated our 41st anniversary of marriage. Ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can as long as you ever can. One of my greatest joys in life is being able to give back. And last year I had a joy of a lifetime. As I were able to get enough money for the Boyd Center renovation that we had the honor of naming a room after my parents, Charles and Denise Castle. My mother taught me and inspired me through example that a life of giving and a life of generosity is the way to live. And my dad taught me that a love for numbers and a love for science, and he also taught me that a woman can do anything she wants. That's why we honored him. And on the day of the dedication of that building, we got to take my parents, who are 86 and 87, into that building, and they got to see their names on that room. And they were overwhelmed. But their happiness was absolutely nothing compared to the joy that it gave me. Giving is important. And now, students, I want to encourage you to think about giving back. We have been blessed beyond means here to have generous people who have given to us. We think about the Welcome Center. Think about the Boyd Center. Think about the Student Union. And there are people in this room, like Suzanne Teal, who have given large gifts so that we can have those projects. And there are people in this room who have made a big difference in scholarships and in new projects. Now, I hope that you students can go out of here and just be so wildly successful that in 20 or 30 years, you'll be able to also give at that level. But let me say, even today, that when you become alums, you can help your university. Did you know that our ranking in U.S. News World Report, there's one part of that is about alumni give. Doesn't matter what our alumni give, but it's the number to give back. And wouldn't it be kind of fun to be able to brag that we are the highest rated university in U.S. News and World Report because so many of our alums gave? And I'm not talking about a lot of money, but when you leave here, think about $5 or $10 or whatever you can give, because that really would help the rankings for the paper. But every dollar that you give to the annual fund would go right into scholarships. And so you would be giving back to that next generation. And $5 makes a difference because it wouldn't be a lot of $5. So just think about that as you leave the paper. So, you have some of my secrets to making a wonderful life. Let me end my little story. When I was at Johnson County Community College, my colleagues there knew that I loved its wonderful life. That became kind of a joke for them. And so there was a charity auction that they bought me, which was a lunch with Carolyn Grimes. Now, Carolyn Grimes was the actress that played little Zuzu, George Bailey's daughter. So she was 5 or 6 in the movie. Now, she's a really important part of the movie, and so I'm getting to have lunch with her. But now, think about this. This is just a few years ago. The movie's over 50 years old, so Zuzu is not 5 or 6 anymore. And she walks into the restaurant, she looks a lot more like me than she looked like this little girl. But we had such a wonderful lunch, and she autographed some pictures and had a great time. But as she told her life story, she talked about all the challenges and some of the heartaches that she'd had, and in many ways, what we might think, it might not have been a wonderful life. But she was so calm, and she was so joy-filled that she said, in spite of all of that, I really have had a wonderful life. I have friends, I have family, I have a job I love, I have a perfect partner. I get to travel. I love talking to others who are going through adversity. And I've really gotten to make a lot of people happy. Most of us have heard that familiar scripture in Ecclesiastes about the time and the season, and the time of the born and the time of God. And certainly my time of my season here at Baker is coming to a close. But there are two verses after all of those times and seasons that I also want. And it's that I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live. That each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in their toil. That is a gift of heaven. So here's my thought for you. I hope you have that gift from God. I hope that they're happy. I hope you do good. I hope you enjoy your relationships. I hope you love your work. Thank you for letting me be part of Baker University. Thank you for the wonderful life for the last 7 years and 1.5 years that you have given to Dennis and to me.